Want to call to order the Finance Committee meeting for April 5th, 2016. Our first item, before we get into the agenda, we will recognize our mayor, who will make a special Employee of the Month recognition.
Okay, Mike Lippman, come up here and join us, and I think we need city council and staff to come and join us as well. We're here for a special recognition today for Officer Mike Lippman. Lieutenant Mike Lippman started with the Muskogee Police Department in 2004. Working his way through the ranks, Mike was promoted to sergeant in 2014 and was very quickly promoted to lieutenant last month. Lieutenant Lippman is a member of the Special Operations Team. He is very engaged in training both inside and outside of the department. Lieutenant Lippman is one of the only instructors in the state of Oklahoma trained to teach the civil response to active shooter event, which has been taught to over 60 different businesses, schools, churches, organizations in the local and surrounding area over the past year and a half. Lieutenant Lippman is also a trained instructor for the law enforcement response to active shooter, which is the law enforcement training side on how to take down an active shooter. Lippman is proud to have assisted in training approximately 95% of the Muskogee Police Department, a very high percentage in the law enforcement industry. Mike's biggest passion is to deter an active shooter event from occurring in our community. Mike has been married to Sarah Beth for 8 years and has 2 children, Wrigley and Kaysen. In his spare time, he enjoys spending time with his family, building furniture and crafts out of wood, working in the yard and playing softball with fellow officers in the Muskogee Police Department. I have been part of the active shooter training at our church, and Officer Lippman was there, did an absolutely marvelous job. And is being scheduled to come back again and do a second training. I want to say we had about 50 in the first group, and we're anticipating about 50 in the second group. He and 2 other officers from the Muskogee Police Department did a marvelous job in about an hour and a half training and taught us some information that we absolutely needed to know in event we'd ever get into an active shooter situation. So, Mike, we want to say thank you for being Employee of the Month, for being nominated and being selected, and you have done an outstanding job. You represent the city of Muskogee incredibly well, and we're proud of you.
Thank you very much. I didn't know I was going to have to talk. So the active shooter thing, very proud of it, something that we are very passionate about. And if you have a business that would like to have it, please contact Lincoln Anderson. He'll get us lined up to come out.
Thank you, sir. I'm going to let you go ahead and shake hands with everybody. Okay. Thank you.
Congratulations.
You're not rubbing that in, are you?
Y'all have a little money laid on that or something?
No. Nothing like that.
Okay, just checking. Just trying to get to know you a little bit.
All right, back to the agenda at this time. Item number one, please.
Consider approval of Finance Committee minutes of March 22nd, 2016.
The minutes, are there any corrections or additions to the minutes?
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second that we accept the minutes. Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gulley.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item 1 passed. Item number 2, please.
Consider approval of claims for all city departments 3/17/2016 to 3/30/2016 or take other necessary action.
Do we have a report from the purchasing committee?
Yes, sir. The purchasing committee met earlier today without Mr. Hall. Had to aggravate him a little bit about that. And we reviewed the claims, and I move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second that we approve the claims. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item 2 passed. Item number 3.
Consider approval of low bid with Ross Construction for the reconstruction of the Military Boulevard subgrade in the amount of $60,000 or take other necessary action.
Mrs. Stewart.
Yes, this project is to improve the sub base on Military Boulevard. And we put an aerial shot together so you can see on the left of the screen, that's where Military Boulevard actually intersects with 69 Highway. And just beyond that, to the right or to the east, Azalea Park, right about where the L is in Military, that's where the concrete ends on that portion of the street. That's where this project would begin. It would go 1,400 feet, which is almost halfway to 24th Street. This would include going in front of all the businesses that are out there, the new hotels that have been constructed. As you can see in this picture, we have just kind of kept that road in a piecemeal condition while all that construction has been going on. In that photo right there, if you'll look, you can see where the very top of the road is. That's where it breaks over, where the crown actually breaks over, and that's just about where that 1,400 feet ends up. But the road has been in pretty poor condition. We have been in constant contact with the hotel owners out there and told them that when all those hotels were finished being constructed that we would start on the road work. Well, that is where we are now. And we did have a pre-bid conference a couple of weeks ago and had quite a few in attendance. Actually had four or five. We explained the project to them. What we're trying to do is get a contractor to come in and do the sub-base work. Now, the city intends to do the blacktop, the 2-inch blacktop, ourselves. We don't anticipate this project taking more than a week or two at tops. It'll kind of depend on the weather. It looks to me like it could be done in a week, the sub-base part, and then the city could put the paving down there in a couple of days, depending on the availability of the asphalt. And we intend to go right in there and pave that as soon as the sub-base is completed. We intend to make the road the same width. We're going to tie into the new existing curbings that are there on the right side of that picture. And that's a picture looking from Azalea Park back to the east. That's where the project would actually begin. We did have pre-bid conference. We do have this money budgeted through our 0.25% sales tax. So the money is in place to do the road construction. It was something that we planned on doing this year. The street committee is aware of what we're trying to accomplish. We did review the bids. The bids are very much in order. There's one that is considerably higher, but if you look at the unit costs, and we put those in your packet, if you look at the unit costs, his unit costs were considerably higher than everybody else's. Everybody else's were pretty much in line, and they're pretty much in line with what we felt as our estimate when we were putting this project together. So in saying all that, we have worked with Roscoe, and Roscoe is very good at this type project. We do recommend approval of Roscoe, and I'll answer any questions.
Mr. Stewart, is there any reason why we didn't go all the way to 24th?
One reason is that the area from the top of that hill onto the east is in a considerably lot better shape.
Okay.
And we could actually just put a top on it. It's that part from that 1,400 feet where those hotels were constructed, where the turning movements from those construction vehicles, the concrete trucks and the delivery trucks, really tore that road up.
Okay.
So, and anything from that point on, we felt like as the city we could accomplish that. But this portion here really needs some subgrade work.
Okay. So when we top over the subgrade that the contractor is going to do, we can go all the way to 24th and just make it. And I'm only concerned because once we do the 24th Street project, it'll look kind of mismatched to have that one patch that's nothing done to.
No, we intend on tying that all together.
Okay.
So that Military 24th and the new Martin Luther King all are nice in that
okay.
area. And actually, we were even looking at Military on around the curve. So
move for approval.
Definitely understand your point.
I have a motion and a second. Any other Questions or discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Cauley.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number three passed. Item number four, please.
Consider approval to declare real property 5.54 acres located at Green Hill Cemetery as surplus and authorize the city manager to negotiate a contract to sell with Muskogee County Board of Commissioner or take other necessary action.
Ms. Callahan or
Chairman and Committee, this is actually, and you'll refer to the slide there, you can see that actually the county has been using this property that they're offering to purchase. It's already being used. We have deemed that we can actually do without this property. We have asked, and I'm going to let our city manager confirm that they do place a fence around this so that the encroachment will stop. Commissioner Doak had approached Mike Stewart, our Public Works Director, early on in his tenure as commissioner, because I'm understanding that he's wanting to build a new county barn there. But this sale of this will absolutely not affect the cemetery for future projects, for future expansion. And as a matter of fact, the funds collected on this will 100% of it will go back into our cemetery care fund and will actually fund a project that we have in the near future. So I not only ask that you approve it, I really strongly recommend that we pass this.
So, Mr. Tucker, what kind of, do we even start with a price, or usually we just start talking about surplus, it's usually heavily discounted price.
Well, and we have, I believe we did a appraisal on this property, didn't we, at one point?
I'm not sure that an actual appraisal was done. What I have done is actually compiled what, if we were to sell each grave space, we know what it would approximately be worth, and it is a phenomenal amount, actually. But we have also taken into consideration that the commercial property value, as well as that's kind of a farmland area there, from what I understand, and then also the counties are brothers and sisters, so we want to make sure that we're all kind of coinciding here. The number one thing was once again they're already there using this property. This transaction will not only put money into our coffers to where we can fund this. Most of you have been here while I've been talking about our Columbarium project. We recently had a place surveyed back in the back for cremation, and the sale of this is actually going to fund this first phase of the Columbarium, so that we have no monies coming out of our cemetery fund extra, as well as there'll be no tax dollars for our part. So that's why I'm really encouraging this sale. This is why we have come up with this amount that we can live with, and we didn't want to get crazy with it because we was afraid that we would scare the county off.
I guess my issue is land's land, not just to start selling off an assets, and you see so many cemeteries start all of a sudden running out of property. Mm-hmm. I really don't mind giving the 50-year lease for a dollar, let them use it.
I've got a point that you may not be aware of, and I think I'm aware of. I think over the years, and without our knowledge or consent necessarily, the county has used a large portion of this area as a dumping ground. And it's going to be real impractical, from my understanding, if we put a cemetery back there, we're going to have to essentially raise out 6 or 7 feet of this to get it all cleaned up in order to make it a practical aspect. My understanding is it's real impractical to go try to piecemeal and dig things up. Is that correct?
Correct.
So we're kind of in a, you can have it.
Because this use has been one that has gone on for decades.
Years.
And
that be the county's problem, not ours?
Well, and when Commissioner Doak came into office, he said, you know, we'd like to solidify this and offer to purchase it or acquire it to get it off of your rolls and also to fence the area. So I thought we had an appraisal done. We can go back and check on that. What we're asking is to authorize me to negotiate a sale of this property to bring back, of course, for your approval.
But if there's anything bad on it, there's going to be an environmental study, and we won't be able to sell it without cleaning it up.
Much like we do our sales with the county and they do with us, we do them by quitclaim deed.
Okay.
And so what we'll do is open up a dialogue with them to actually start talking about dollars as it relates to this, because anything that has been dumped over there that is buried, that would have been, it wouldn't have been us. And so I don't know what is over there either. I've heard the same comments that Councilor Kale has heard. And so simply what we're asking you to do is to, for you all to authorize me to talk to the county and see if we can reach an agreement on something like that. And we can certainly inquire as to their interest in some kind of lease option as well. And I don't mind that at all. I know that Cemetery was certainly looking forward to some additional revenue if we were to agree on a sales price for the columbarium project, but we'll explore all avenues and bring something back.
My dad said they don't create any new land.
Yeah.
That's true.
That's ours, and
that's right.
And Mr. Gully, to address your concerns, and I completely understand them. We under the former superintendent Glenn Faith, he actually opened up or had cleared about 7.5 acres of property in approximately 2003 or 2004. He and I at that time had the conversation and did a 20-year projection for that 7.5 acres to fill up. I actually opened that up for sale in 2007. Since then, we have sold property as well as have burials in there, totaling just under 1,400. So you're looking at, out of that 5,250 grave spaces open in that 7.5 acres. So you're looking at in the past 9 years, we've sold off, you know, right at 1,400. What we're looking at is that 20-year projection because of cremation rates, and it's directly because of that. That 20-year projection is actually going to extend out to about 25 to possibly even 30 years. Every type of projection that we're looking at, by the year 2018, we're looking at the national average being about 55% cremation. Yeah. There are many states that are exceeding that right now. So we are not concerned, even with the sale of this 5 acres, we're going to have plenty of space for years to come.
Well, I'm still concerned. My grandson's 4.
Yeah.
So you're going out 30. I'm going out 100.
Well, but we also have enough property to actually last, projecting at today's rates, close to 200 years.
Okay. I'm still not a real fan of this idea of giving up land.
Any additional questions? We have a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve this item. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
No.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number 4 passed. Item number 5, please.
Consider approval of a reduction to medical insurance contributions for the city and each employee medical tier effective May 1, 2016, or take other necessary action.
Kelly?
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. For clarification, I wanted to ensure that the council was aware the intent of the medical reduction tiers for the 10% reduction in all tiers for medical for the employee and all of the employee portions of the medical premiums was the intended date of May the 1st.
Kelly?
Yes.
In the background, there's a date of May 1st, 2015, but you are, in fact, talking May 1st, 2016, correct?
Yes. Okay. I apologize for that, yes.
Not going to be retroactive.
Right, okay.
No, not retroactive. May 1st, 2016.
Okay, just checking.
Yes.
Sorry.
That would be a deduction to the insurance fund of $55,000 for the city's contributions and an additional $12,000 for the employee contributions for the next 2 months. And then it would be a total of $404,000 in insurance benefit year 2016-2017, which is May 1st through April 30th. And this was recommended by the insurance committee, and staff recommends approval as well. Happy to answer any questions.
And Kelly, just to clarify for the council, this was what you had discussed at our last meeting, but we didn't actually get clear direction on whether or not that was something that we wanted to move forward with, so that's why you've put this item back on.
That's correct.
Okay. Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other further discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Copern.
Yes.
Thank you.
Item number five passed. Item number six.
Consider the appointment of John Winters to the Parks and Recreation Tree Board to serve a 4-year term beginning May 1st, 2016 and ending on April 30th, 2020, replacing Oscar Ray, or take other necessary action.
Councilman Coleman.
Dr. John Winters has been a very active contributor in our community. He's an employee at Bacon College. He has a PhD in recreation and park development, and certainly we are glad to recommend him as a member of the Parks and Recreation Tree Board, and I move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Yes, I have Mr. Chairman, may I ask a question?
Yes.
I ask a question on every appointment that comes along, and I ask the same question. Mayor, Councilman Coleman, is this particular person, is he a minority?
Are we allowed to answer it that way, Mr. Tucker?
Depends on the purpose for using it. Since we're not talking about employment, I think it'd be permissible.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right, any other questions or discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Copern.
Yes.
Okay, item number six passed. Item number seven.
Consider the appointment of Holly Rawson Miller to the Chamber of Commerce Committee for Convention and Tourism to serve a 3-year term beginning May 1st, 2016, and ending on April 30th, 2019, replacing Dan Hall, or take other necessary action.
Councilman Keel.
Holly Rosser Miller, I believe, is an asset to the community and very active in the community, and I think she would make an excellent choice for this position.
Questions?
Move for approval.
Councilman Reed, may I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Councilman Keel, this is nothing to do with you, anything like that, but I always ask this question because on these boards, I like to see diversity. So I'm going to ask you the same question. Is Ms. Miller a minority?
No, sir.
Thank you. We give the floor back to you, Chairman.
All right. Roll call, please.
Can we get a second on that? Okay. Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Copern.
Yes.
That item passed. Item number eight.
Consider approval of the appointment of Justin Walker to the Planning and Zoning Commission, replacing Dave Davis, to serve a 3-year term beginning May 1st, 2016, and ending on April 30th, 2019, replacing Dave Davis, or take other necessary action.
Councilman Johnson.
Dr. Walker is a member of our community that served in a couple of different positions. He was a principal out at Harris Job Elementary, currently a principal at Grant Forman Elementary. Very connected with our community and serving in a number of different areas. I think he would serve very well on Planning and Zoning Commission.
Any move questions?
Mr. Chairman? Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Van, if I can, as the presider of this meeting, ask that we pass this time. I think your point has been well taken, and we have several more appointments to go, and I kind of feel it's kind of redundant to keep interrupting the flow with the same question. And I think that the process we have in place as far as each councilman has a choice, I think that the boards that are being filled are fair at this point. I think I want to pass as far as you are calling that with the same question, if you don't mind.
Councilman Reed, that sends a message. I'm just simply asking a question, like Councilman Kale answered the question just a while ago, which Mr. Miller is a minority.
We're going to do this on every appointment. We're going down the line. I think your point has been well taken.
Well, people that's listening, people here in Muskogee need to know. I mean, whether we are putting minorities on these boards or we're not putting minorities on these boards. I know if I was a citizen, I'd want to know. If I don't know these people, how are you going to know if they're a minority?
I think the process that we have created that gives each counselor an opportunity to make sure that these boards are fair and diverse. Minorities, those are the choice of each councilman. I think it's, like I said, I think that we kind of taking it too far by continuing to do this after every appointment. So with that, I'm going to move forward. I do have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Gulley.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number 8 passed. Item number 9.
Consider approval of the appointment of James McCracken to the Merit System Board to serve a 2-year term beginning May 1st, 2016 and ending on June 1st, 2018, or take other necessary action.
Councilman Coleman.
Pastor James McCracken is the pastor of the Boulevard Church here in Muskogee, Oklahoma. He has been an extreme contributor to our community's well-being. He has experience not only from the pastoral perspective, but in other areas of work and having served in different personnel capacities, and I recommend approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to ask you the same question again. Is this a minority, which I know it's not, just like the last one we just voted on wasn't? So I'll say it myself. So I'll yield the floor to you, Madam Chairman.
All right, Mr. Chairman. We have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Gulley.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number 9 passed. Item number 10.
Consider the appointment of James Gulley as our representative to the EODD, Eastern Oklahoma Development District Board, and to appoint Mike Stewart as the alternate representative, or take other necessary action.
Deputy Mayor Gulley.
I'm not really sure why I'm listed as the presenter.
Well, here's if, you don't mind. If I can speak on this. Mr. Stewart and I had the privilege of meeting with our the local executive director of the Eastern Oklahoma Development District, and he pointed out that the city of Muskogee has an appointment on the EODD that has not been filled for a number of years. So I asked him to send me the information as to the term of that, and then I looked on the list of who was next in charge to make an appointment, and that was Councilor Gulley. And so I'd also had conversations with him about his willingness to serve on the EODD board because of his seniority with the city. And secondly, the information that I was given was that typically they want to appoint an elected official to serve on the EODD board, and then they'll appoint an alternate. And then they've asked everyone else, the members, to appoint an alternate member who's generally a staff person, so that if the elected official is unable to attend the EODD meeting, then a staff person could be able to do that. Historically been involved with a lot of capital improvements related to roads, bridges, being able to bring economic funds here to repair those, we thought Mike Stewart would be a good alternate for that. And so that's why you're listed as the recommender.
Oh, I didn't understand that.
And also the reason why we have you listed here as the representative. So okay. Happy to answer any questions about that appointment. But we've had it for a number of years, and I don't know the last time that we exercised our right to have somebody on that board. But with the EDA grant that they're helping us to maintain, it's certainly timely that we exercise that appointment and put somebody on who can represent the city of Muskogee for that.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Yes, I'll answer this question for you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stewart is a minority, and we put 3 minorities on these boards, and I think they're very, very good.
Thank you.
So I'll yield the floor back to you, Mr. Chairman.
And do you realize I'm Cherokee? Thank you.
Okay. That's all right, Mr. Gully.
I told him his poem was well taken. Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item 10 passed, and that brings the closure of the Finance Committee.
We'll now call to order the Public Works Committee meeting. Item number one.
Consider approval of Public Works Committee minutes of March the 22nd, 2016.
Any additions or changes?
Move the approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
And the motion carries. Item number two.
Consider approval of a resolution declaring the property adjacent to 1902 Emporia Street as surplus property and authorize the sale of the property to Christine Maxwell in the amount of $363 or take other necessary action.
Mr. Root.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Christine Maxwell purchased the property on Emporia in February of this year. We've had a piece of property adjacent to it. It's a small piece of property, not a buildable lot, but it's adjacent to her home, and she would like to purchase that property, and she's come in and deposited the money and signed the papers. So I bring that to you today. We've had this little piece of property since 2005, so it's probably time we move on. So it's an adjacent property owner. It's the appropriate thing to do, and I recommend approval.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any comments? Discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Motion carries. Item number three.
Consider approval of amended Council Policy 3-3-3, vacation leave policy, or take other necessary action.
Ms. Plunkett.
Good afternoon again, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. Historically, the AFSCME employees and the general employees, those not covered by a collective bargaining agreement, have been treated the same for most benefits. It was realized during an audit, I believe, that our general employees are not receiving the same vacation benefits as the AFSCME employees at this time. I'm recommending increasing the last tier of employees who are 20 years and above to 168 hours per year. Right now, the last tier for accruals is 160 hours for 15 years and above. So again, this would be including another tier for 20 years and above to receive 168 hours per year. This is a budget impact potentially of $3,200. I apologize in your background. I had $7,900. There's only 17 non-uniformed employees that this would affect. Happy to answer any questions.
So this basically just makes everyone receive the same accrual rates?
That's correct. AFSCME employees and general employees.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
And the motion carries. Item number four.
Consider acceptance of ODEQ permit number WL00005115-0987 for the construction of 662 linear feet of 6-inch PVC potable water line and all appurtenances to serve the College Heights addition, Muskogee County, Oklahoma, or take other necessary action.
Mr. Stewart.
Yes, this is just an ODEQ permit that we're required to have council action on to accept the line so that we can have maintenance on it. As you can see on the PowerPoint slide, where the yellow arrow is, that's where the actual water and the next item on the agenda, the sewer. Actually are. That green area is frontage off of Shawnee Bypass. That is on the west side, and that's where the new Studio 6 has been constructed. So these lines are for the Studio 6 construction. We recommend approval.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion or questions? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
And the motion carries. Item number five.
consider acceptance of ODEQ permit number SL00005115-0988 for the construction of 90 linear feet of 8-inch PVC sanitary sewer line and all appurtenances to serve the College Heights addition, Muskogee County, Oklahoma, or take other necessary action.
Mr. Stewart.
And again, this is the same. This is simply the sewer line that was constructed to serve the Studio 6, and again, this is something that's required by ODEQ, so we recommend approval.
Thank you.
Move the approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion or questions? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gulley.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
The motion carries. Item number 6.
Consider approval of agreement between Cowan Group Engineering, LLC and the City of Muskogee for professional engineering services for the Muskogee Citywide Water Distribution and Analysis, or take other necessary action.
Mr. Stewart.
Yes, Tim Ward is here with Cowan Group, and will help me field any questions that might come for Cowan Group. But if you'll remember, we did go out for a request for proposals or qualifications for consultants to come up with a water distribution analysis for us. And when we did so, we had a committee that actually shortlisted and did interviews, and then we selected Cowan Group. We put that on the council's agenda, and council did approve us to enter into negotiations to come up with a scope of work and a fee for that water system analysis. So that is what you have before you today. That is in your packet. The scope is to really get into the water system and help us determine what we need to have in moving forward for our capital improvements program. It is basically in several different areas. One is the raw water supply, and that's looking at the 48-inch raw water line, and that's also to help us develop an emergency response plan if something was to happen to our raw water supply. You know, that way we wouldn't be scurrying around trying to figure out what to do. We'd actually have some action in place. That is to look at our distribution system improvements, and that's to look at our transmission lines and the water leaks that we have, and help to analyze what we're currently doing to repair those, to see if we're doing the proper procedures. If there's something that's going on around the state that somebody's doing better than we are, it's to have somebody independently look at and review and help us determine if that's the way we need to go. And that's to take several sessions with staff, interview processes on each one of these different aspects, and help determine a scope of work that needs to be put forth in a capital improvement plan that will be brought back to City Council for review and approval. We started out negotiating with Cowan Group, and if you've looked in this has several tasks in it that are listed, and it's itemized on each one how we'll try to develop those goals. We started out negotiating with them, and we were in an approximate $150,000 range. I will remind you that this is funded out of sales tax and that we only actually appropriated $100,000 for this project. We as staff sat down with Mr. Cowan and Mr. Ward and negotiated that, and we got it down to $123,000, and we actually all felt like if we kept cutting any more out, we would really lose purpose in what we were trying to get to. So $123,000 is what the not to exceed amount is, and if you look on page 6 of 7 in that contract, it does have a fixed fee amount of $123,200. This is $23,000 over and above the amount that's appropriated in sales tax. So I'll have to get with Gene and Roy and try to determine how we come up with that other $23,000 if this is approved. But I assume that money is in that arena. I will be glad to answer any questions. We as staff did have several conversations with Cowan Group, and again, we did have them at the table. We did negotiate each item. We talked about all 6 phases, the way it's broken down in the billing, the planning and data gathering, and we actually sent them over to visit with Tammy and Pam to discover what they had as far as the water loss audit was going to involve. And so as staff, we really tried to break this down to what were real numbers. And that's what we came up with. We recommend approval. We will surely have many reports to bring to you as this progresses. And again, Mr. Ward is here from Cowan Group, and I'll try to answer any of your questions.
Mike, what's the time frame for this to be completed?
We don't have one identified, Mayor. I think we originally looked at a six-month period, Tim, but...
we're still looking at probably now that it's been a month later.
So, yeah, six to nine months is what we're looking at. And I know you couldn't hear Mr. Ward, so trying to have it here to you by the end of the year. Okay. We'd like as staff to have it here quicker, but we don't want to go so fast that we don't do a thorough job.
Move the approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other questions?
My concern would be the funding. Where would the other $23,000 coming from? Is it a tight budget year?
It is a tight budget year. We've made a number of cuts to free up some of our capital expenditures, but we do have a bit of funds left in the general fund that we intend to carry over for next year, and so there will be a small surplus in there, and we can pay that out of that. Okay. So we would have
earmarked funding for this project?
Not for the $23,000. It's not earmarked. That would just be out of
we had 100 earmarked.
Right.
That's what was put out okay. as a...
But the additional, I think you said it was $23,000. That
yes,
would have to be.
Yes, and Councilman Johnson, we slashed it every way we could and really didn't want to go any further with it.
That would just come out of the carryover for next year for our from the general fund.
So, Roy, we couldn't put that in next year's budget since this is a nine-month project, the other $23,000?
Depends on when the budget's going to take place. The problem with that is if we sign the contract, we're binding ourselves to
in this budget year,
and that the fund for next year has not yet been approved. Mm-hmm. So I'd be hesitant to recommend doing it that way.
Can I recommend that we just move this forward to Monday and then let Roy and I sit down and see where we can get that $23,000? Because I know we can shake it loose somewhere. We just got to look. And it's very important to us at Public Works. If we have to shake our budget, we'll do it.
So I've got a motion and a second. Should we go ahead and vote, since then we can always take it off the agenda if we don't like the...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'll be good. Yeah, and then idea. We can identify the source and we can notify everyone, put it in the background information yeah. when we send the new packet out. Okay. That'll work.
Is that all right with this committee to go ahead and yeah. vote on this?
I move for approval.
I think I've already got a motion.
Got a motion and a second.
Okay. Yeah,
great. Right.
That was my roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Jenny Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Motion carries. Item number 7.
Consider the agreement between the City of Muskogee and Traffic Engineering Consultants, Inc., TEC, for professional services to design plans to modify traffic control at Main and Okmulgee, Main and Broadway, Main and Court, Cherokee and Okmulgee, Cherokee and Broadway, and Cherokee and Callahan for a lump sum fee of $36,000 or take other necessary action.
Mr. Stewart.
Yeah, this is another item that was on the sales tax vote. This was for the improvement to the signalization at the Court Street Viaduct is the way it was actually described. It was approved for $250,000 through the sales tax. There's also some money that was left over from when we actually moved the money from the viaduct that was supposed to go over Okmulgee Street by Tumble Inn back many years ago when we improved the Green Bridge, the Court Street Viaduct. When that project was completed, there was about $70,000 to $80,000 that was left in that account that is available to be spent on this project. So we have roughly $320,000 identified to do a project to improve the signalization. And we have started calling it the Downtown Four Corners Traffic Signal Project. And Morris, I appreciate it, put his little slideshow together real quick. And this is an agreement for professional services to design plans to modify traffic control to better serve vehicular traffic as a result of the street closures along a rail line due to the trains. And anybody that goes down through there knows that when there's a train on the UP line, everybody for some reason wants to go across the Green Bridge or the Court Street Viaduct. And especially when you're traveling south and you're wanting to turn east up onto the bridge, there's not a permissive left turn. It's only got a green ball, and usually one car can go, and that's just about all that's allowed to go over that. So the other problem that exists at this location is that on the east side of the viaduct, it's actually controlled by a four-way stop sign. And I don't know if you remember, but there used to be a traffic signal there, and we did have traffic engineering consultants actually look and review this many years ago and come up with some alternative methods to move traffic along, and one of them was to do a four-way stop. And the reason that was done at the time, that was a mechanical traffic signal that was on that side, on the east side, and they interconnected all the signal lights on Main Street when they redid all those signals. So the new interconnected traffic signals that were working along Main Street then couldn't communicate with the old mechanical style that was on the east side of the Court Street Viaduct, causing the need to either upgrade that light or take it out. And at that point in time, it was $100,000+ to do that, and the money wasn't there, and that's the decision was to come in and put a stop sign in there. We looked at that point in time to put a two-way stop in where we were only stopping Cherokee Street and letting Callahan flow, and a lot of people wanted it that way, but there's a, if you think about it, when you go over that viaduct, when you come on the east side of it, there's a building on the south side that is right at the corner, which is a visual issue, and we felt like that could cause some major problems, so that was the decision to put the four-way stop. The four-way stop works fairly well, but not very efficiently when there's a train there. When there's a train there, it congests all four directions, and it does back traffic up. So what we talked about was putting some type of a signal project together that actually talked to the train system so that we would have some type of a control mechanism that actually was activated when there was a train on there that would tell the light at Main and Court that there was a train there and could actually activate a permissive left turn to help move that traffic along. Now, when you think about it, that permissive left turn doesn't need to be there all the time. It only needs to be there when there's a train, and it only needs to activate when there's a train. So that was the decision to try to do something like that. And I don't know how many years ago we actually hired traffic engineering consultants to put a project together, and that's how we came up with the $250,000 that we went out for on the sales tax vote. They put together a project that would have four signals basically talking to each other or working together, and that would be the one at Cherokee and Okmulgee, the one at Main and Okmulgee, the one at Court and Main, and the one at Cherokee, and then it turns to Callahan. And then, of course, the two on Broadway are kind of in the middle of those, so they're kind of affected. To make it a little better to understand, and I forgot Morris put me a little slide together to show you, but those are the basic four corners that we have. There would have to be a new signal that would have to go in at Cherokee and Callahan. And, of course, I'm telling you all this without really having a design put together, and that's what this contract is really for. It's a contract with traffic engineering consultants, and Mr. John Eshelman is here with the traffic engineering consultants. And if you don't know, traffic engineering consultants have been the key player in almost all the traffic in Muskogee, whether it be city, state, or county. They've been the big player, and they are very aware of our traffic movements, and they're very big in the traffic issues in the northeast part of Oklahoma, and I think even down to Oklahoma City, and I don't know where you go from there, but a very reputable company that's worked with us many, many, many times. So, again, they did help put the initial concept together. We had actually written a letter at that time to the state because we felt like there may be some historical funding out there because of the viaduct being the age it is. And we approached them at that, and, of course, we didn't get a response. But that's the reason we hired them, was to try and come up with a scope, a fee, what we thought the project might cost, and then go after some funding. And, again, we failed. So once that happened, then we decided to put it on as a vote of the people on the sales tax, and we did, and that's where we came. It was actually $170,000 when they originally put it together, and we raised it to $250,000 when we put it on sales tax. So after the sales tax vote passed, and I've been stating all along, we at Public Works have been managing so many projects, as some of them fell off, we'd start taking on some others. Well, we're almost at the end of a couple of projects. The Martin Luther King is getting very close to the end, the East Side Sewer Interceptor, our drainage basins, they're all coming to a conclusion, so we're ready to start some more. And the thought was we'd get going on these signal projects. So what you have before you is an agreement between the City of Muskogee and Traffic Engineering Consultants. Matt has reviewed it. Staff has reviewed it. I've discussed it with Roy. It's for a fee of $36,000. That is in that sales tax, so the money is there. And I do recommend approval. I have John Eshelman here from TEC and Morris here from Public Works, and we'll try to answer your questions if you have any.
Thank you, Matt. Questions?
Move for approval. Exciting project.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any comments? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston. Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Dwayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Band.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Eric Coburn.
Yes.
The motion carries. We have one citizen wishing to speak to this committee. Mr. Van, the floor is yours.
Ivory Van, 911 Holden, Muskogee, Oklahoma. I come up here today. Last Monday night, we voted on the contractor to do the bathrooms at Robinson Park. This is my opinion, and also it's also factual. When the contractor done Robinson Park before, they poured the basketball court, and the basketball court, they poured all in one day, and they shouldn't have done that. And when they poured this basketball court all in one day, they had to work with the flashlights on the cars. I get they got it all finished pouring the next day. They should have put barriers around the court to keep people off of it. We had cars go down there and just make U-turns around the court, and that was wrong. They should have put barriers up. Also, the basketball court, it holds water. Where it's supposed to be draining down, where they're supposed to shot a grade on it, it still holds water. Also, on some gazebos we had put up down there, they formed all these up, the same guys that done the basketball court were out of Texas. And what happened was, when they done the basketball court, they got kind of a little trouble. They went to jail. That's what happened to that crew. They went to jail. And so after they got out of jail, I guess the contractor fired them because he brought some guys in from Tahlequah that done the other job for the gazebo, both gazebos. So last Monday night, I voted no because I didn't want them to have bathrooms. I voted no because I wanted a different contractor. And I have pictures and I have video of everything that went on down at Robinson Park during this time. And all the thing I want is for Robinson Park and Honor Hikes to have the best contractors and the best craftsmen to do this work down there. And I feel at Robinson Park this last time on that phase two, we did not get the best work. But I just wanted y'all to be aware of this. But this time, trust me, I'm going to be watching more thoroughly, and I know Mr. Martin's going to be watching his job more thoroughly, and we definitely going to get some craftsmanship, because I know the people in Honor Hikes ain't going to go for it, and just like the people in Midland Valley is not going to go for it. And I appreciate my time up here, but I just wanted to make some things clear that wasn't brought up last week, that it wasn't because the company went out of business. It's because those contractors went to jail because they were drinking. And I got a picture of all of them, too. So it's no hearsay. It's nothing but factual. So, I hope every one of y'all get to come down to Robinson Park and go down to Hikes and look at these projects. You need to get out and look at what's going on in our community. You know, I went by the King Center the other day. I seen some things I didn't like down there that the contractors need to go back on. But, so, like I say, it's just, you know, everybody got their own opinion. And trust me, as a councilman, I get out and I look at stuff. And I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Seeing that we have no other citizens wishing to speak, we are adjourned.
We will now call to order the special call business, special call meeting of the Muskogee City Council. Roll call.
Mayor Bob Coburn.
Here.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Here.
Dan Hall. Marlon Coleman.
Here.
Janie Boydston.
Here.
Wayne Johnson.
Here.
Patrick Kale.
Here.
Ivory Band.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Here.
We are accounted for. Item number one, please.
Discuss and take action to accept proposal and, if appropriate, add alternate from recommended vendor to provide Wi-Fi infrastructure at Hatbox and authorize the city manager to negotiate and execute a contract or take other necessary action.
Mr. Tucker.
Mayor, members of the council, this was tabled from our last meeting due to some questions. Staff has gotten together. We have created a new review committee. That review committee consisting of Mike Stewart, Gary Garvin and Ty Pickering have taken a preliminary review of the proposals, and they have, due to some questions, requested in-person interviews. So those in-person interviews of the respondents to the RFP are scheduled for Wednesday. So as a result, we don't have a full recommendation. My request then is that this item be tabled until the April 11th City Council meeting, at which point we will have a full recommendation ready for your consideration. Happy to answer any questions.
Do we need a motion?
To table.
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Is there discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes. Motion carries. Item number two.
Consider approval of the appointments of Jack Bethany, recommended for appointment by Councilor Derek Reed, Jay Updike, recommended for appointment by Mayor Bob Coburn, Brandon Royce, recommended for appointment by Mayor Bob Coburn, and Kevin Crank, recommended for appointment by Councilor Dan Hall, all to the Uniform Building Code Appeals Board, to serve a five-year term beginning May the 1st, 2016, and ending on April 30th, 2021, or take other necessary action.
Mr. Tucker and I will probably take care of this one together. If you would strike the name of Brandon Royce that was read, that recommendation will not be made. So the three recommendations would be Councilor Reed recommending Jack Bethany, I, Bob Coburn, be recommending Jay Updike, and Councilor Hall be recommending Kevin Crank. Those would be the three recommendations.
And if you all may remember, this board was one of the new ones that was created to handle appeals of the building codes. It's been vacant with the exception of one member since it was created, particularly because of the difficulty in finding the professions that have to be represented. Mechanical contractor, fire, at-large member, electrical, plumber. And so now we've gotten to the point where we do have an appeal that has been made, so we do have to constitute the board. So that's why we've got this on our special call rather than a Public Works or Finance meeting. And so these recommendations were as a result of staff calling and making requests for these individuals. Mr. Updike fills the position of engineer, and then Bethany serves in the position of code because of his prior experience as a code supervisor code enforcement and the building inspector, and then Mr. Crank Tish, his recommendation is
local realtor,
okay, is covers the real estate building professional category. So happy to. And then Mr. Royce, his name unfortunately was stricken because he is not a resident of the city. So we apologize for that. So happy to answer any further questions.
Mr. Tucker, are there any of these appointees and minorities?
Did you ask them?
No, I did not. And I don't know that I have an answer as to whether they are or not. I don't know.
Move for approval.
Second.
So a motion and a second. Is there a discussion?
It's good, you know, like I say, people appoint, people, I think that, should know, and, because I'm going to ask this question every time, because like I said, I've been to a lot of board meetings, and where minorities is not represented, but we here at the city always want firemen and different ones to be on the and minorities, and minorities need to be represented on these boards. That's all I can say about this. I mean, I'm going to ask this question every time this comes up. And so you can ask me the same thing when I appoint somebody. Trust me, it's going to be all diverse. And I'll make one of my appointees has always been diverse. You can go back and check the record. I'll yield the floor back to you, Mayor.
Are there other comments or questions? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes. Motion carries. Item number three.
Consider approval to enter into a contract negotiations with Gardner Construction as the low bidder to provide and install RV power centers at Love Hatbox Sports Complex for the Jesus Music Festival, and further authorize the city manager to execute the same or take other necessary action.
Mr. Ewing.
I don't really have a pony. I guess that would be Jim Blair.
Ooh.
I don't see the dog either.
Mayor, Council, Manager, Staff, this is part of the infrastructure enhancement that is taking place at Hatbox with regard to hosting special events out there. Obviously, the first one coming up is G-Fest in mid-June. These are the special event power pedestals. I noticed Mr. Blair posted a photo on Facebook today of the road work that is being done from the end of the runway, south runway, out to border. It is cleared now, and you can see all the way out to the golf clubhouse. The very first response to this was, can we bring our trailers in and hook up now? Kid you not. So this is so they can come in and hook up their trailers. And I asked Mr. Blair today, and they have almost 80 of these already rented for the event. So we have 160 hookups that will go, as you saw in your packet, on the east end of the east-west runway. We will have 60. I'm sorry.
No, that's good. I just wanted to yeah.
And we have 80 on each side. And each one will have electric power, 50-amp, 30-amp, 220-amp plugs, and a water spigot as well. And each one of these will be isolated by a water valve, so if for some reason, you know, something happens to somebody, we can isolate that, and we don't take the water from everybody else. Staff would recommend for approval, and I would be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I've got a question.
Yes, sir.
You've got plugs for 30 amp, a plug for 30 amp, and a plug for 50 amp, and then 220s.
And 220s.
So a total of 120 amps available?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sound like a bunch to me.
Yeah, according to code, the demand factor on these, you design at 40%.
Rick.
Yes, sir.
Could you talk a little bit about the bid on this? Didn't we only received two bids on this? But based on the pre-bid conference, we thought we had three general contractors who were bidding on that.
That is correct. We had 16 people at the pre-bid conference. Well, it turns out six of them were staff. One person was at the wrong meeting. He was there for tree clearing and dirt work, and nobody knew why he was there. There was somebody there who was unknown, five subcontractors, and then three general contractors. So out of that assemblage, there were only three people who were going to bid anyway. And one of them was Zenith Construction, and they have several projects ahead of them, and they decided to go with another project because they thought they could make more money on that project.
So what kind of protection are we going to have around these pedestals?
They are actually isolated out on a 4x4 concrete pad away from where the vehicles will be.
Because it just looks like something's going to happen to them. That's just human nature. Move for approval.
Mr. Mayor, may I address Mr. Ewing?
You sure can.
Mr. Ewing, have you known anything about this construction company? Have you used them before?
We have not used them before.
You checked their work?
Have you? No. They have come with a nice pedigree, but we have not contacted previous people.
I think it would be a good idea to you're going to hire somebody to work for you. You should check their pedigree and go out and look at their work and get a good, you're going to be investing this kind of money. And those pedestals look good, and we need some good craftsmen to put them in.
Mm-hmm.
And I would suggest personally that someone needs to go out and look at their work and get the, scope. Mm-hmm. I can't see hiring anybody and bringing them to my house and not knowing what they can do. Mm-hmm. This,
Yeah, point well taken.
That's just my opinion,
Yes, sir.
Do we have a layout on how these are going to be done? Are they just going to be 80 down one side, 80 down the other side, and they're going to be across from each other? Are they going to be staggered?
Yes, sir. No, they'll be across from each other. There is actually ample room to back them in and have, like, there are people who will tow cars as well, and there is ample room in the center for car parking. Mm-hmm. They will be across from each other and running up 80 each side from the east end. So it's, you know, somewhat isolated up on that end of the property.
Is this going to create an issue with a motorcycle event going forward? Is that being considered?
At this point, it is not. And there are some circumstances with that, with SFM, that I can tell you about later. Okay. that we probably should make you aware of.
Okay.
I've got a question in general, not real intimate with the project. Do we have sewer disposal and water hookup?
That is something that we are talking about. We are talking with a plumber now. We know a spot where we can do a dump station. And obviously, as with all of this, you know, we'd have to meet code. And we are in conversation. We had a meeting with Mr. Blair yesterday, and we are in conversation now about trying to find a plumber to do a dump station for us.
Have you considered the surrounding area where we could run a sewer line and tap into it?
There is nothing out on that end that we could access, where we could have positive fall. But what we do have is on site, adjacent to one of the exit, small secondary exit roadways, and it works beautifully as in for a dump station for a single unit.
Okay.
So the mayor's question about design, the contractor, do they recommend how these units may be placed so that we can be certain going forward that it's not?
Staff will place them.
Staff will place them.
Yes, we will.
I guess I'm just concerned about the design of the thing to be certain that after this is over, you know, they've been a design, something has been done outside of just staff so that we know that they're being placed correctly so that for future events, there's no collision or excess traffic in one area or one direction.
We did last week, actually, 2 weeks ago, I went to the Expo Grounds at Tulsa to measure their facility. And they have, you know, a nice, well-used facility up there for event parking. And ours are significantly larger. So the space should not be a problem.
And I think there's a code provision for how these can be laid out.
There
as well.
Is. And, okay. And all of ours meet or exceed all existing electrical plumbing codes both.
There's not further questions. We'll entertain a motion.
Gary, do you remember how the ones were in Shawnee and the places we went to visit were? How they were for the sewer?
What?
The sewer, how it was hooked up. Did you pay any attention to that? I didn't.
They did not have sewer. They may have had a dump station on site, but they did not have sewer at their hookups.
I forgot myself.
Yeah.
And one other thing, Councilor Vann, since the authorization is only to enter into contract negotiations, we can determine the qualifications and the references that they've provided to ensure that we do have a quality contractor doing this bid.
Thank you, Mr. City Manager.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there other comments or questions?
Mr.
Ah.
He had already done.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry.
We trumped your motion with another motion.
Okay.
Mr. Goldman can trump mine.
No, no. We won't be doing that.
All right. We'll take either one of them.
Take Mr. Gully's.
Thank you.
Are we ready for roll call?
I like seeing my name in print.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Vann.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Mayor Cope.
Yes. Motion carries. Do we need to read this item?
Yes.
Okay. Item number 4.
Consider an executive session to discuss and take possible action on the following. A, pursuant to Section 307B2, Title 25, Oklahoma Statutes, consider convening an executive session to discuss negotiations with the American Federation of State, county and municipal employees, local number 2465, and if necessary, take appropriate action in open session.
And Mayor, Council, if I could, before any action is taken, staff's request is going to be that this item be stricken. We have a little bit more work to do in order to get something ready to discuss with you. So we will then put something on for Monday night. So if we could just take no action on this item, that'd make me happy.
That completes our agenda. Thank you for joining us.